tonight. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a good hand clap of praise. I said, just like I said this morning, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Yes. Amen. Listen, we had a mighty fine time this morning in the Lord. The power of God was in this building. Listen, sometimes if I get carried away preaching, I'm just preaching to myself sometimes. Just shout right along with me. Amen. This morning I was preaching to myself. Amen. Praise the Lord. Nevertheless, I'm super excited to be back in the house of the Lord tonight. Listen, who believes that God has something in store tonight? Look, it's not by happenstance that you showed up to this building. You didn't just show up because it was a Sunday night for service, but you showed up because there was a divine appointment waiting on you in this building. Do you agree with that tonight? Amen. Listen, we just need to cash in on that divine appointment tonight and just let the Spirit of God do whatever He's going to do. Amen. Amen. Anybody have any prayer requests tonight?
Remember my family prayer.
Yes.
I'd like to give an update on my grandma. I don't know if I mentioned, I think I did, that she has been walking around. She's been eating some. They're giving her a lot of pureed food. So she had some turkey and gravy that was pureed, blended. And she had some.
Let's go ahead and pray. I'd like everybody to pray out loud with me. Let's just welcome the Spirit of God in this building. Father God, right now we come to you. Jesus, we begin to ask, God, that you move on each and every one of these requests that were presented in this building tonight. Father God, Lord Jesus, if it's your healing, divine touch needed, God, I pray that you will go right where it's needed, God, and meet that need. Father God, Lord Jesus, I pray right now that your Spirit, God, will infiltrate this building, Father God, Lord Jesus. I pray, God, as we are opening into this service, God, that each and every request, God, whether it was healing, Father God, Lord Jesus, or whether it was conviction needed or whatever it is, God, we know that you are more than enough. We know that you are Jehovah Jireh, God. We know that there is nothing too hard for you. So, Father God, Lord Jesus, we welcome you at the Unity Church of God tonight, God. This is your service. Have your way. Pour out your Spirit, God, in this building tonight. Father God, Lord Jesus, I pray that you will anoint every song sung, God. I pray that you will anoint every musician in this building, God. God, I just begin to pray that your Shekinah glory, God, will come down tonight, God. Lord Jesus, that when people pass on Piney Road, God, they'll feel something different about this building, God, and maybe it'll compel them to come in, God. Lord Jesus, we just begin to pray, Father God, in unity in this building tonight, God, that your Spirit fall tonight, God. Lord Jesus, we didn't just come just to have church and leave. We didn't just come, God, so that we could check mark that we were in church, God, but we came so that we could have a life-changing, life-altering experience. So, Father God, Lord Jesus, move in a mighty way. Have your way in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen and amen. Brother Don and Sister Ann.
Turn to page 214, please. He knows how.
the Lord. Who's glad you've got the devil under your feet in this building? Amen.
Yeah.
Down, down, down under my feet. Well, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There ain't nothing he can do that's going to have effect over you. You're the head if you're not the tail. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. The words of this song are simple. It says, peace, bring it all to peace. The storm surrounding me, let it break at your name. Aren't you glad that every storm that's raging around us, that his name can break it? Amen. Oh, hallelujah.
Please bring it all to peace. Storms are
thank you for all that you do for us. God, we thank you for every moment that you protect us. Father God, we thank you for every storm you've ever brought us through, God. Oh, in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, either that was really good or really boring, because we could put the kid to sleep on the stage. So. What was that? It was peaceful. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. So this morning, let me get my life in order here. Give me just a moment. This morning, I started a message entitled, Knowledge, Come and Get It. And I came over here earlier this evening it's in the Sunday morning. You got to switch it back to Sunday morning. The file at the top there where it says open. Yes, yes, yes. Pretty cool. I can run that computer just by the thought of it, hopefully. Amen. But anyway, as I come over here earlier to study, to figure out exactly what I was going to preach tonight, the Lord said, I gave you too many notes for you just to stop there. Listen, I've got 5 pages of notes and made it through 1.5 pages this morning. That was it. But the power of God fell in the building. Amen? So I'm just going to continue with what I was preaching. Is that all right, everybody?
Yeah. Come on.
Again, I was preaching a message entitled, Knowledge, Come and Get It. We talked about where knowledge comes from, and just as a brief cap, we talked about natural knowledge, and then we spoke about spiritual knowledge, and I would rather have more spiritual knowledge than I would rather have any knowledge of the flesh, right?
Amen.
Now, it is, as I stated this morning, it is a law that every child has to attend from kindergarten to 12th grade. That's the rules, right, in the world. Well, we expect education out of our children, but yet we think as Christians that our education ends. It stops, but it definitely does not end, and it does not stop, right? We talked about where does knowledge come from. We stated something that was totally obvious, and it was from the Lord, right? Knowledge comes from the Lord. But then we went in depth on that, and we began to talk about that there are different ways that we can get knowledge from the Lord, right? The first thing we stated was through the fear of the Lord. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, and this is kind of the basis around what I was preaching this morning, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. So we talked about how in order to have that knowledge, we've got to begin with the fear, and it wasn't a natural fear of the Lord, right? It was a reverent fear of the Lord. Listen, we've got a world today that has absolutely no reverence for God, but yet they wonder why the power of God is not being demonstrated in their life. Listen, whatever we allow into our life is as much power that will be demonstrated in our life. Do we agree with that tonight? So anyway, we went on and preached a little bit about that simply put, spiritual knowledge and intellectual knowledge begins at the fear of the Lord. It's important that we fear. The next way that we talked about that we can obtain knowledge, and again, I'm talking spiritual knowledge. I'm not talking going to school, going to college. I'm talking spiritual knowledge. What was another key factor other than what's on the screen there? We said in order to gain knowledge from the Lord, we have to read the Word, right? You don't know it if you don't read it, right? Before Sister Sonia goes to school, she's got to read to figure out what she's teaching, right? She's got to plan her lessons out. She's got to plan all about it because she's got a whole year full of teaching that she has to do, right? It's the same in the body of Christ. We've got to absorb the knowledge, and how do we do that? Is we read the Word and allow the Word to embed itself in us, right? And that way, when you're at a moment that you need the Word, and I don't know if you've ever been there, but I sure have, at a moment that I needed the Word, and it was so embedded in my spirit that all I could speak was the Word in a tribulous moment, right? All I could do is praise God in a storm instead of throw my hands up in defeat. I used as an example this morning, we've got a lot of people that are still living on the milk of the Word and have not graduated to the meat of the Word, and they'll go around, and this is not just people that just got saved, but this is people that have been saved for 20 and 30 and 40 years. They wander around with gloom, despair, and agony on me, and deep dark depression, excessive misery, and if it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all, gloom, despair, and agony on me. Now that gives way to the flesh, right? You agree with that? Listen, the flesh wants what the flesh wants, and the flesh does not want you victorious. It doesn't want you excited. It doesn't want you looking forward to tomorrow. All the flesh wants to do is bind you where you are today and hold you captive. But listen, I've got knowledge through Jesus Christ that says I don't have to remain where I am, but I can move forward. Amen. Listen, I may not be who I'm going to be tomorrow, but today I'm trying just as hard as I can to be better like Jesus. Amen. We talked about oftentimes that when somebody feels like they get such spiritual knowledge, they begin to forget where God brought them from and what God has brought them out of, and they'll look at their brother and sister when they fail, and they'll get them down there, and they'll kick them as hard as they can, and they'll kick them when they're down, forgetting that they themselves have things that they need to work on. So we've got to understand that knowledge is important, but if knowledge gives us a haughty spirit, that's not a spirit of God, right? That's not a spirit that'll get us to heaven, but that's one that can doom us to a devil's hell. Do you agree with that tonight? Yeah. So we determined that number one was, it said that the fear of the Lord was the beginning of knowledge. So it has to start with a reverential fear. Number two, we can seek and find that knowledge through counsel, right? Counsel is good as long as it's godly counsel. The problem in today's church world is we've attached ourselves to people and created soul ties with people that are not biblically minded, that could care less if you are prospering in the Lord, and we're running to them for counsel and questions, and then we wonder why our lives are a mess, right? We wonder why we're in so much turmoil. We wonder why we're in so much confusion in our mind. Listen, if you got any avenue of your life that is confusing you, my Bible says that the author of confusion is the devil. God has absolutely nothing to do with confusion, right? But we tend to gravitate to people that are not exactly the counsel that we need around us, right? And the Bible says that we've got to be careful with that. We've got to take counsel. Counsel is good. I mentioned that my pastor in Ohio, Pastor Rick Lewis of the Shelby Church of God, whenever I run into a snag here or anywhere that I've got a question I'm not sure how to handle, I'll call my pastor up because I trust what my pastor has to say. I told you this morning, and it's a true story. If Pastor Rick Lewis were to call right now and tell me to shut my mouth and sit down, that's what I would do because I take counsel from the man of God. God places people in our lives to give us counsel. But look, if it is negative or if it is contrary to what the Word says, then it's not godly counsel. It's flesh-led counsel. Can I get? I already feel the Spirit of God, and I even got to the new part. Yeah, hallelujah. But we've got to find it through counsel, right? What did that scripture say in Proverbs chapter 19, verse 20? It said, hear counsel. counsel and receive instruction, that thou mayest be wise in thy latter end, right? So when you receive counsel, it doesn't mean that you've arrived. It doesn't mean that you've got it all figured out. But what it means is as the years go by, you'll be able to call up that wisdom and knowledge that's on the inside of you that somebody deposited into your life, and you'll be able to use that in the next avenue of your life. Come on, that's a good word. Listen, there's things now that I can remember my pastor saying when I was growing up that I thought he was crazy. I thought, this guy has no idea what he's talking about. But oftentimes I've got to recall some of those things because it was good counsel. Now, you ever had some good counsel and you ever had some bad counsel? Listen, it's like going in a courtroom. You either have a good attorney or you got an awful attorney, right? You better hope that if you are on the criminal end, that you've got a good attorney. Come on. But listen, Jesus is the best attorney and best counsel that anybody can ever give you. Amen. So knowledge, if you want some, you can give some, but you've got to get into that thing. You've got to have a teachable spirit. We've got a church world today that is not teachable. And I'm not talking necessarily about you in this building, but maybe it is you. Maybe you are dealing with that you're unteachable, that if a man or a woman of God or your friend corrects you, you'll think you've got it all worked out. Let me tell you, I don't have it all worked out. You don't have it all worked out. We don't have this thing all figured out yet, but every day we're gaining. Hallelujah. I'm going home. Come on, somebody. So every day there's got to be a moment of promotion in our life, and we've got to continue in the paths of righteousness, right? So that second way was through counsel. The third way that we talked about where knowledge comes from and exactly how we can obtain that knowledge is through faith building. Through faith building. Who's ever had to encourage yourself in faith? We find in 1 Samuel, and this is not back there on the screen, but 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6, we see that it talks about David being in great distress because the people are speaking of stoning him. And the end of that sixth verse says, but David encouraged himself in the Lord. Listen, there has to come a time in your life that you've got to encourage yourself because your children aren't going to encourage you. Come on, somebody. There's got to be a time in your life that you've got to encourage yourself because your spouse is not going to encourage you. But when you begin to speak life into you, what you're saying is, look, devil, I'm getting in where the knowledge is. I'm not falling for your trickery anymore, but I'm building up the faith that is inside of me. See, David in 1 Samuel chapter 30, he could have given up at that moment. He could have said, well, go ahead and kill me. All the women have been kidnapped and all the houses have been burned down. Go ahead and kill me. But something shook on the inside of David. David understood that, look, it was God that brought me here, God that anointed me when I was young, and it'll be God that gets me to the kingdom. My God, somebody. Listen, when we are in it for knowledge and we're praying and we're believing, I feel the Spirit of God in this building. When we are building ourselves up, listen, I preached this one day here. Exactly 3 days later, from 1 Samuel chapter 30 to 2 Samuel chapter 2, that was literally 3 days. David went from being down and out, everybody wanted to kill him, to where he became king. Let me tell you something. God can turn something around that looks like it's a mess right now. God is able to turn that thing around. You just got to seek him. How do we, this ain't even in my notes, but I feel the Spirit of God. How do we know that David sought the Lord? The Bible says in 1 Samuel 30, I believe it's about the 8th verse, it says that he called for the priest and he called for the ephod. He needed an answer from God. Let me ask you something in this building tonight. When was the last time you you went to the Lord asking him of something and expecting him to do it. David understood that if I can just get an answer from God, I'll be okay. David understood that if I could just tap in to the glory of my God, somebody, if I could just tap in, it's all gonna be okay. I feel like preaching in this building tonight.
Hallelujah.
So we can encourage ourselves and see all of the things that I just told you happened because David was building up his faith. Right? He was building up his confidence in who he believed in. In fact, if you go again to 2 Samuel chapter 2, not only did David get in there, not only did he become king, but David called for the glory of God. He called for the Ark of the Covenant because he knew that the glory of God had departed and he wasn't fixing to be king if the glory of God wasn't there. Let me tell you something. You can have as much natural knowledge as you want, but if you are not kingdom-minded, if you're not seeking the glory in all things, guess I feel the Spirit of God. If you're not seeking the anointing of God, that knowledge is in vain. But if you wake up every morning and you get your clothes on and you say, look, I'm going to work in the authority of God. Listen to me. Maybe you get up for school and say, hey, I'm going to school in the authority of God. All of a sudden, you are changing that intellectual knowledge to spiritual knowledge. And when the enemy comes, the Bible says when the enemy comes in like a flood, that the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. So when the devil comes to you, when you're at school or you're at work or wherever you are, you will have some spiritual insight to see it before it comes. And you'll have the right to say, devil, you can't have me today. I belong to Jesus. Come on, somebody. Oh. I'm fixing to preach in this building. We still ain't got to the new part yet. Bible said in Jude chapter 1 verse 20, but ye beloved, somebody say ye, somebody say that's me.
No.
Beloved, build up yourselves on your what? Come on, that means encouraging yourself, building yourself. Listen, there's going to be people around you that are going to tear you down, but you got to build yourself up. Listen to that. There's going to be people around you that tell you you ain't good for nothing. You got to build yourself up. There's going to be people around you that say they're going to act just like their mama. They're going to, come on, somebody. They're going to act just like somebody around them. And you've got to build yourself up, realizing that God called you, and who God calls and qualifies, you don't have to fall in the same track of what somebody else fell in. Yeah, yeah. But it says, building up yourselves on your most holy faith. I like this next part. Maybe it's because I'm a crazy Pentecostal, but it says, praying in the Holy Ghost. Who's ever just started praying in the Holy Ghost because you didn't know what else to do? And you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, and that very thing that come to seek you out to kill you, all of a sudden it began to flee from you, because all of a sudden you're encouraged and you're on the mountain when you should be in the valley, and you're walking tall when everybody's kicking you to the ground. Now, all of us, after the Spirit of God in this building, there's going to come a time that we understand that we've got to encourage us, and sometimes that means we've got to pray in the Holy Ghost so we can trip the devil up. Oh, come on, somebody. Woo! So we've got to build us up. The devil's out there to steal, kill, and destroy. He hates you. He hates your guts. He hates your household. He hates your family. He hates your mental capacity. Listen what I'm telling you. He hates your identity in Christ. But you've got to build up and say, I know who I am, and I know whose I am. Oh. question. We now have an understanding of how to get the spiritual knowledge. And don't put the next slide up yet. Don't switch slides. I'm going to ask you a question. What's holding you back?
Amen. Come on.
Come on. I don't have some of you left. I am. You are. Come on, somebody. God ain't there holding you back from your destiny. God ain't there holding you back from your blessing. Come on, somebody. God, come here. Stand up, Charity, for a second. Now, you got to understand, I preach this morning, I'm tired, I'm fat, and I'm lazy. So you just act like you're strong without actually being strong for a minute, okay? Try to walk through that arm. Don't knock me over, though. Try to walk through that arm. Come on, just press forward. It's not like God's doing this to keep us at bay from our blessing. What he's really doing is he's coaching you on. But what the Bible says, that the steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord. So what's really happening is God is propelling you forward when you don't know what's going on. Oh, my God, somebody. He's not trying to stop you. The only one that can stop you from your destiny is you. God is doing is trying to get you from glory to glory, to get you to your destiny, so you can get to a place in him that the devil may come against you, but he can't destroy you. He's trying to get you to a place that you've got confidence inside of here to know it don't matter what you think about me, it don't matter what you say about me, all that matters is what he says about me. Come on, somebody. So who's holding you back? You are.
Amen.
How do I know that? Because we're going to have to take a break or a nap or something. Because the Bible says, intermission, hold on. That he come to give us life. And life more. Somebody just say that word more. Abundantly. So we've now uncovered what God is doing, right? But what are you doing? Listen to me tonight. We've uncovered what God is doing, but what are you up to? Are you there saying you want your blessing, but you're sitting on your hands? Come on, somebody. There's a song that said, the words just slipped my mind. If I remember it, I'll come back. Listen, I got 20 million songs running in my mind all day long. Come on, somebody. Listen, there's sometimes that the devil comes in and he'll start messing with us, but what in the world is holding us back?
Yeah, right on.
So let's go on. Do I got you for a few more minutes? Now we're into the meat of this thing. Matthew chapter 7, verse number 7 says this. Ask and what?
It shall.
Somebody say that word shall. Hold up now. Ask and it
shall.
Listen, that just put a definite upon the request that you asked for.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. It didn't say it might happen, right? That scripture don't say that, right? It doesn't say, maybe if God's in a good mood today, right? Come on. We saw enough in the Old Testament when God wasn't in such a good mood and he destroyed everything. Come on. Aren't you glad we got grace through Jesus that he ain't destined to destroy anything? Come on, somebody. But he's given grace and grace through you. Aren't you glad for that? But it says, ask and it shall. Somebody say it's mine. Come on, I want to hear you say it out loud. Somebody say it's mine. Come on, that means that healing you're looking for, it's yours. That spiritual knowledge you're looking for, it's yours. Somebody say it's mine. My God, somebody. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. In other words, the only thing holding you back is you. Because he said if you'll ask him of anything, he'll do what you ask him. In other words, guess what? If you could get the flesh man out of the way and you say, God, whatever you've got for me, give me wisdom, give me knowledge, give me revelation, give me insight, he is able to do that because you asked and he's going to give it unto you.
Yeah.
Now, but hold up. What is that predicated upon? Because if I go out here, start asking for a BMW, you think God's fixing to bring me a BMW? I just pick on BMW. I don't know nothing about cars. I don't care nothing about cars. As long as I can put that key in, start the thing, and it goes, that's all I care about.
Come on.
No. But when we ask things that align to His will, come on, somebody. Listen, I could ask God to give me a 20-passenger van, but if it's in my will and not His will, I'd use that thing in vain, and I'd go in bankruptcy. Come on, somebody. But if I start asking God, what is the desire of your heart? I feel the Spirit of God in here. What is the desire of your heart? What is your desire for my heart? If I begin to ask that, and all of a sudden a 20-passenger van shows up, I'll know that it wasn't me who made it happen. Listen, a lot of people, they go to a loan company, and they get this big loan, and they get this beautiful car, and they say, it was God's will for me to get that. Listen, it may not have been God's will. It was you having a job that got that. But when you know that it's the will of God, you'll go in with confidence, saying, I don't know how it's going to happen, but God's fixing to do it. I don't know how I'm going to pay for this, but God's fixing to do it. Come on, somebody. See, because it's got to line up with His will. Proverbs 26:12 says, seest thou a man wise is in his own conceit? There is more hope of a fool than of him. Did you hear that? Seest thou a man wise in his own deceit? Listen, this is a man that is unteachable, untrainable. Listen. God expects us to be pliable. Come on, somebody. God expects us to be moldable. But when we are so into our own conceit, and we are so embedded into that thing, we get a righteous spirit that says, I know everything. I know more than you. I know more than God. I'm going to do it my way, whether it works or not. Come on, somebody. The verse says, seest thou a man wise in his own deceit? Question mark. There is more hope of a fool than of him. So what gets in the way? We get in the way. Amen. We do.
Amen.
Listen, I'm trying to get through this. Woo. Listen to this. James chapter 1, verse 8. A double-minded man is what?
Unstable.
Come on, say it again.
Unstable
and what?
Always.
So I didn't say just sometimes he's unstable. You ever met somebody that's an alcoholic? And I'm talking, they're drinking from the time they wake up to the time they're going to bed. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes, listen, I've got an uncle, he's still today. Every day of his life, ever since I've known him, my whole life, he's an alcoholic. He drinks from the second he wakes up to the second he crashes. And there's a time about middle of the day that he starts to get unstable. And somebody got to get over there. They got to help him. Come on, somebody. Because guess what? And all of a sudden, not only is he unstable, but he's incapable of making decisions because he's unstable. And all of his ways are wrecked because he's unstable. So let me ask you again, who gets in the way? You and I get in the way because we get ourselves double-minded and unstable, and yet we wonder where the blessing of God is. What in the world is a double-minded person? Somebody that says one thing but does another thing. Come on, somebody. Come on, we all know somebody like that. They'll speak blessing in front of everybody, but they live like the devil in the dark closet. Come on, somebody. Somebody that blesses God on Sunday but drinks and smokes drugs on Monday too. Come on, somebody. It's somebody that'll love you to your face and backbite you when you look. Oh, come on, somebody. You want to know what somebody who is double-minded is? It is somebody who is putting on a facade on the outside, but they are no more safe. saying to the drunk in the bar, listen, God is not looking for somebody to be half in. You've got to be all the way in, or he don't want you at all.
Amen.
Give me just a moment. Let me get to this one. Number three. Be encouraged. God didn't bring you to this moment and this level to fail you. Right? Do you believe that? God didn't bring you to this level of awareness to fail you. Listen, today we've got something called a woke community, is what they say. Somebody who's woke, they think they got it all figured. Turn your news on. That's what they call it. People that are woke. They're all of a sudden woke about everything. When before, they must have been asleep or something, because they woke up and now they got life all figured out. Let me tell you something. We have nothing figured out. Nothing at all. All we need to know is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came. He lived. He ministered. He was crucified. And on the third day, listen, I don't need to be woke about anything. I'm not fixing to be a woke culture. I'm fixing to be a woke, saved, Holy Ghost filled Christian on my way to heaven. All I need to understand is he said he's coming back. And listen, before he was crucified, laid in a tomb and resurrected, he said he was going to do it, and he did it. So I believe, just like he came out of the borrowed tomb, that he soon and very soon is going to come to get his children. So that's the only courage that I need. Listen, talk about woke culture. I'm a woke Christian, praise God. I woke up one day and said, devil, I'm tired of it. I'm tired of them. I'm tired of your confusion. I'm tired of your demands and your, and your destruction. I'm tired of you wrecking my family. I'm tired of you destroying kids. I'm tired of it, devil. Come on, it's about time we get woke as a body of Christ. Come on, we just laid down and we let the devil come and kick us. Well, I've laid down too long. I ain't fixing to lay down anymore. I rose up and I'm not going down until Jesus comes to get me. I feel the Spirit of God, somebody. Hallelujah. I'm not going down because I know whose I am. Oh, but we've got to encourage ourselves. We've got to understand that when we begin to pray and encourage and be encouraged, that God is able to reveal knowledge and wisdom and revelation. All of us. Woo! Hallelujah. Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 17 and 18, this is what the Apostle Paul said to the church of Ephesus. He said, take another intermission. Let me say this. This was our theme verse for Church of God Youth Camp this year. Envision was the theme. But it says that, this is what the Apostle Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of what?
Wisdom.
Come on, you better say that. May give unto you the spirit of what?
Wisdom.
And what?
Revelation.
In the
knowledge.
My God, somebody, did you just get that? Come on, that's the will of God concerning you. This is what the Apostle Paul was doing. He was encouraging the church in Ephesus that God came so that you can have wisdom and revelation and knowledge. In other words, you don't have to be dumb in yesterday, because God has redeemed you for something better tomorrow. Oh, hallelujah. But they give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Go to that next verse. Here's what he began to say. I love this. The eyes of your understanding being what?
Enlightened.
What does it mean for somebody to come enlightened? It means that all of a sudden a bell or a light went off in their mind. And all of a sudden they start thinking different of themselves. They may be held captive by drugs and alcohol, but all of a sudden they've been enlightened to the freedom of the gospel. All of a sudden, come on somebody, they may be living in a life of prostitution and drugs, but all of a sudden a light comes on. Oh my God, somebody, this is what Christ came to give us. Woo! I'm sorry, I'm a little wild, y'all. But ye, that ye may know what is the hope of what? Who's calling? Oh, come on, say it again. Woo! What's the purpose of having knowledge? So that we may know what is the hope of His calling and what the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints. In other words, He gives us knowledge to know what our inheritance is. Can I tell you what my inheritance is? I don't have to die and go to a devil's house. I can go to glory to be with Jesus. That's what my inheritance is. I don't have to die in my sin. Oh my God, somebody. Woo! Hallelujah. I may as well just sit up here with you all. I ain't never going to shut up if we keep going. The Apostle Paul began to give them some insight to what was going on. He began to encourage them. Yes. So let me say this. What is it that you need to encourage yourself? That knowledge will let you know that the I am that I am is on the scene. Listen, knowledge will let you know that God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that you can ask or think. This spiritual knowledge will let you know, even on the worst day, that the devil is still defeated.
Amen.
Oh. You get up here and try to preach. It just happens sometimes. So, I think I've taken a bath in sweat tonight. Woo. But let me tell you something. I need you more. More than yesterday. I need you more. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, I need you more than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, more than anything, and Lord, as time goes by, I will be by your side, 'cause I never want to go back to my old life. So I need you, I need you. Thank you. listen, I need him more today than I ever did yesterday. I need the knowledge, the insight, oh, from the Spirit of God. I need the enlightenment. I just need all of it. Hold it. I need you more. Come on, just lift your hands in this building. Listen, I know you want to go home, but stop worrying about the time for a minute. Lift your hands in this building. Father God, I need you more than I've ever needed you before. Father God, I need you more. I need you more. Father God, I need you more than any riches that I've got, God. I need you more, God, than anything in this life. Father God, bestow on me your knowledge, God. Bestow on me your enlightenment, God. Bestow on me your wisdom and your revelation, God. Oh, Father God, I pray for everybody in this building, God. God, I pray that you will expand their spiritual knowledge, God. God, that you will give them the ability to stand toe-to-toe with the devil. God, and let them know that they are victorious. Father God, I pray right now a supernatural boldness come upon the people that are under the sound of my voice. God, I pray spiritual, supernatural boldness to stand in the face of the devil and say, I will not succumb to your sin. I will not succumb to your mentality. I will not succumb to anything that you've got planned. But God, I pray for this congregation. I pray for all that's under the sound of my voice, whether they be in this building or on Facebook. God, I pray that you will give them boldness to stand toe to toe with the devil. I pray that you will give them boldness to seek after spiritual knowledge, God, and increase it daily. I pray, God, that you will make us a people of instruction. God, that you will make us a people of listening, God. Father God, all we want is to do your will and do and be whoever you want us to be. So, Father God, I pray right now a release of your Spirit in this building, God, in the name of Jesus. I'll keep singing. If you're in this building tonight and you need something from the Lord, I want to encourage you to get out of your seat. I wouldn't leave this building the same way that I came here tonight. I'm not talking that you're lost and undone out in sin, but what I'm saying is you need another insight of his knowledge. You need some more of him in your life. Let me encourage you, step out. We'll pray with you. We'll lay hands on you. We'll believe that God will give you wisdom, knowledge, and revelation, and insight. Come on, if it's you in this building, come on out, step out, we'll pray. Come on, do that one more time. Come on, by the end of this, we'll end the service if you ain't made your way up here. More than yesterday. Her body from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. Father God, I come
every devil in hell that attacks this body in the name of Jesus. I come against every devil in hell that torments this mind in the name of Jesus. God, I speak freedom from the bonds of the enemy in the name of Jesus. Father God, we know that you are able. So God, we call upon a God that's able and know that he is willing and able to do that which we request in the mighty and holy God, oh Jesus, touch it, God. Touch it, Jesus, in Jesus' name. Oh God, hallelujah. I feel the Spirit of God in this city.
Come on, is there anybody else in this building? Yeah.